Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. Don't eat too much. Keep social distance. Wear your mask. And be blessed. Let us pray. Father God, we just come to say thank you. Thank you for another day that you have made. A day that we will never see again. We just come to say thank you. You're an awesome God. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hide self and just use thy servant, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Today's lesson says, peace and justice reside. A new day is coming. And it's coming from Zechariah, the 8th chapter, verses 1 through 8. And fast forward to verse 11 through 17. The golden text says, which is Zechariah 8 and 15, it says, so again have I thought in these days to do well unto Jerusalem and to the house of Judea, fear ye not. The unifying lesson principle says, sometimes people respond to evil conditions in the world with a sense of hopelessness, regret, and doom. And the question comes to mind, where can they find motivation for continuing? Well, Zechariah is coming today to tell us that God is going to deliver. God promises of a new day of peace and prosperity for God's people. Our objective states, we want to pray for God's presence to result in a community of saints that will be motivated for justice, prosperity, and unity. All right? Let's just look at some biblical background. Following Zechariah's rehearsal of Israel passed in chapter 7, he told them went on and he told them what the things that they weren't doing, and he came back and told them what God wanted them to do. But then he came back in 8 and he gave them some hope. He started talking about the future will bring Jerusalem repopulation. All right. He also stated that not only will Jerusalem be full of people, but conditions will be peaceful as well, because there were turmoil in the land. People will grow old there, and children will play in the squares. But the condition will only come into existence when Yahweh returns to Zion to dwell in Jerusalem. In other words, God had to be in the midst for this to happen. When you look at Zechariah chapter 1 and 2, you find out that he's echoing the same thing in chapter 8. He's just expanding a little on it. He said Jerusalem will be called the faithful church, the faithful city, Yahweh the mountain, Zion will be called Holy Mountain. The book of Zechariah is almost the same as the book of Daniel, because they unveiled God's promise for his chosen people, the Jews. The book of Zechariah was written after the Babylonian exile. It is the 11th book of the 12 minor prophets. Zechariah was both a prophet and a priest. The name Zechariah means the Lord remembers. His father's name, Barashiah, and I think I pronounced that right, Barashiah name means Jehovah blesses. His grandfather name, Ido, means his time. And when you put all those three, the meaning of all those three names together, guess what you got? He remembered to bless in his own time. So Zechariah was fulfilling the truth of the meaning of his name, of the combined names. Zechariah had a series of 10 visions. And all of his visions, he looked beyond the his day to the millennium future of the nation of Israel and Jerusalem, reminding them that God had a plan to bless them in his own time. And God has a plan to bless us in his own time. His timetable is not our timetable. We can't rush God, all right? I know you've been waiting and you've been talking and you've been praying for things to happen. But guess what? It's going to come in God's time, not our time, all right? If we look back at the first six chapter, this is where 8 of his visions were described, all right? And then he had 2 years lapse. Then he had a series of the other visions. And then we go down into chapter 7 and 8. We get a record of a question being asked of him, where some of the Jews that were from Bethel, they wanted to know, did they have to continue to fast? Because the building, the temple was being rebuilt. Well, it was a memorial, when the fall of the temple, the downfall of Jerusalem, they had a 4-annual fast to remember it. But they figured since they started building the temple that they didn't have to do the fasting anymore. And so they proposed that question to Zechariah. Zechariah did not want to, he didn't want to waste too much time on that question. So he went on to describe what God's concern was in his vision for the and his plan for the Jewish nation. Times were difficult for the 50,000 Jews who had returned to Palestine to reestablish the city of Jerusalem and the temple of worship. It was a hard time. This remnant laid the foundation for a new temple, but hostile opposition halted the work and it discouraged the people. They had a lot of stuff that was going on. Economic distress. They had bickering among themselves. Financial situations. Some of them in Haggai, they talked about they were supposed to be building the temple and they started building their own houses instead of finishing building the temple. So the Lord sent, called Haggai and the young man named Zechariah to go down to talk to them, to arouse them up and to put some spunk in them and let them know they needed to get about doing their father's business and to finish the work. God people doesn't live on explanation. I don't care how much you explain it to them. You got to put a promise to it. And they live on promises. Faith and hope are nourished by the promises of God given to us in the scripture. We are motivated by the promises God has given us. And that explains why Zechariah didn't spend too much of time trying to answer that question. He just wanted to focus he focused the people's eye on faith, on the future, and he shared some of the wonderful promise to encourage them to get about their father's business. And the first part of the chapter, the lesson, which is verses 1-8, we're talking about a new stature. A new stature. They got a new position with the Lord. All right? A new position with the Lord. Verse 1 says, "And again the word of the Lord of hosts came to me, saying, Thus said the Lord of hosts, I was jealous of Zion with great jealousy, and I was jealous of her with great fury." All right? And you're looking at that first verse, you see the word of the Lord of hosts. Zechariah, that phrase was mentioned 18 times in that chapter. 18 times. Jerusalem was mentioned 6 times, Zion mentioned twice, and word jealous were mentioned 3 times. Zechariah wanted to let them know that this is not coming from me. This is coming from the Lord. The Lord is the one that told me to tell you that. He also told them that God revealed his change of attitude toward them and since the destruction of Jerusalem. All right? The Jews had provoked God to jealousy by sinning and rebelling against him. And then his word says, this commandment says, I shall have no other God before me. God is a jealous God. All right? He could not bear the fact that they had turned away from him. He did not want to. That made him angry, all right? And because of the fact that they turn away from him, it's God looking down on us. And when we turn away from God and we fall out of fellowship with God, he get angry with us because he wants all of us. He wants us to put him first in our life. 3 says, thus saith the Lord, I am returning unto Zion, and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem shall be called the city of truth, and the mountain of the Lord of hosts, the holy mountain. Thus saith the Lord of hosts. That's that phrase again. There shall yet old men and old women dwell in the street of Jerusalem, and every man with his staff in his hand for very age. All right? In other words, he's saying, I'm going to live in the midst of, whatever it takes or whatever it requires to restore them as my people, I will do that. And that they have, in order to restore them as my people and their relationship with me, then I will do that. I will resume my presence with them. All right? This was a new era for Jerusalem. I'll bestow a new stature upon the city. Jerusalem would be characterized by 3 names: the city of truth, the mountain of the Lord, and the holy mountain. Because God will be in the midst of the city. And when God is in the midst of something, it characterizes truth. And it characterizes good deeds. All right? They could only have truth, and that the inhabitants could only be, their behavior be aligned with God. All right? 5 and 6 said, 5 says, and the street of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in the street thereof. 6 says, thus saith the Lord of hosts, that phrase again, if it be marvelous in the eyes of the remnant of this people in these days, should it also be marvelous in my eyes, saith the Lord of hosts? In other words, a new day for Israel. Israel's future would be one of peace and security. All right? And they could not understand that. They stood in awe. They couldn't believe that God was doing this for them. All generations, old and young, will prosper and live together in peace without fear of invading armies or any forms of oppression. They stood in awe. They didn't think that this was possible. But Zechariah let them know, nothing is too hard for God to do. All power is in his hand. Things that appear to be marvelous in our eyesight are routine for God. God deals with the impossible. This coronavirus, it seems impossible. But God is the possible God. And he knows and he cares and he loves us. And therefore, he will do what he have to do on his time. God affirm his jealous love and his concern for Zion, just as he had done earlier in chapter 1 and 14. He promised Jerusalem that Jerusalem would be rebuilt and become a whole different city dedicated to truth and holiness. The promise will be fulfilled when Jesus Christ returns to the earth to establish his kingdom. And that is in Isaiah. You can go back in Isaiah in chapter 1 and 26 or chapter 2 and 3. These are just a few of the chapters you can find out. God is a compassionate God. He loves his people. He's not worried about the building. His concern is centered on the people. In today's society, man-made cities, the elderly and the children aren't safe in the street. Huh? People are being killed. Young being killed. The old, when they feel that you're no longer useful, they have legal ways of trying to end your life. But all of that will change when Jesus returns and the righteous reside. 7 says, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Behold, I will save my people from the east countries and from the west country. 8 says, And I will bring them, and they shall dwell in the midst of Jerusalem, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, in truth and in righteousness. Here God, Zechariah is telling them what God is saying that he's going to do for them. God has promised that I'm going to save my people. He said, I'm going to gather them all up, all of those that have been dispersed all over the place, all over the world. Then he said, I will identify them as my possession. He said, I will have a unique relationship with them and say, I will be their God in truth and righteousness. A new day is coming for the redeemed, in which peace and justice will reign in the spiritual Jerusalem. Question comes to mind. In what way do you visibly reflect your status in God, in Christ, your standing in Christ? In what way do you visibly reflect your status in Christ? All right, we're going down to verse 11 through 13. We're looking at the reverse fortune, what Zechariah is talking about to his audience. He says 11, but now I will not be unto the residue of this people as in the former days, said the Lord of hosts. For the seed shall be prosper, the vine shall give her fruits, the ground shall give her increase, and the heavens shall give their due. And I will cause the remnant of this people to possess all these things. God promised, and he's no shorter than his word. He promises this. And 13 says, And it shall come to pass that as ye were a curse among the heathen, O house of Judah and the house of Israel, so I will save you, and ye shall be a blessing. Fear not, but let your hands be strong. Work for the Lord. Do work for the Lord. This is where Zechariah prophecy comes into realization. All right? He's telling them what God says, what he's saying he's going to do for them. All right? It's like an advertisement. He begins by exalting the remnants to take courage and heed, like Haggai and Zechariah taught them regarding the completion of the work that they had started, and they left it for their own reasons. They had reasons for leaving it, you know. But Haggai and Zechariah promised that they see that they needed encouragement, all right? Because they were despondent because of their situations, they said. So Haggai and Zechariah promised to be present among them and give them the encouragement when they begin to work on the project. All of us need encouragement at times. I don't care what phase of life we're working on. I don't care what phase of work we're working in. I don't care what we're doing, whether it's for God or whether it's for in your home or whether it's with your children, whatever you are doing with your hands. God said, even your mind, you need that encouragement. In time like these, we need the encouragement from one another, okay? And there's nothing wrong with that. Then Zechariah went on and he began to tell them that he contrasted or he compared what the conditions were in the last time when they started the wall and they had to stop. And now the condition now. He said three conditions existed prior to your rebuilding of the temple. You had economic distress, you had insecurity caused by enemy threats, then you had internal strife among yourself. That was in 9 and 10, but that's not in our lesson. But these were some of the reasons why they stopped building on the temple. But he said God promised a renewed relationship with his people based on their repentance. See, they had to do something. That was an expectation of them, all right? He said, if they repent and do what thus said the Lord, the harvest would be saved secure and abundant. They would have adequately amount of seasonal moisture to moisture the agriculture. Their inheritance is secured by God's covenant. All right. There should be a sowing of peace, meaning that God has a return in their presence. That is a positive result of God turning toward the people with compassion. Now God's attitude had changed. All right? It had changed toward. All right? Then he said, just like the condition of the community was a sore eye to the nations around him. You see, all this would change when God reversed their circumstances. Instead of being a curse, the nation would be a blessing. We as believers had a reversal in our life. Our past condition was not the same now. And it was only made possible by the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. And because it was made possible, we should be able to produce much fruits and bless the lives of others by living a righteous life among them. Question comes to mind. When have you experienced a divinely orchestrated reversal of a circumstance or a situation in your life? Well, you knew it wasn't man that did that. You knew man couldn't do this. The stroke of a pen couldn't do it. Friends in high places couldn't do it. It was nobody but God. God is the only one that can take a situation and turn it around, a bad situation, and turn it around to be a good situation. The last part of our lesson is coming from 14 through 17. It's a divine confirmation, God's new purpose. He had a purpose for him, a new name, a new purpose. 14 says, "For thus said the Lord of hosts," again we see that phrase, "as I thought to punish you when your father provoked me to wrath, said the Lord of hosts, I repented not." 15 says, "So again have I thought in these days to do well unto Jerusalem and to the house of Judea. Fear ye not, these are the things that ye shall do." And there were some requirements that they had to do. There are requirements that we have to do to live up to because we are born again believers. All right. These requirements are: speak ye every man the truth to his neighbor. Execute the judgment of truth and peace in your gates. And these were the ones that sitting in the gates, like the lawyers and the priests and guard and stuff. He says 17, "And let none of you imagine evil in your heart against his neighbor, iniquity, and love no false oaths, for all these are things that I hate, said the Lord." So there was some expectation, divine confirmation. I got a new purpose for you. I'm going to bless you. You're going to have plenty. You're going to be bountiful. You're going to be safe. You're going to have peace. But contingent upon that, you have to do expectation. And these are the expectation. See, that the fall of Jerusalem was no accident. It was directed result. It was a direct result of sin against God and their failure to repent. All right. Just as he had planned their punishment, now God is planning to do them good and would not relent. The promise he made were conditional, and they were accompanied by specific expectation. God wanted them to practice honesty in their speech, in dealing with others, have a life that is characterized by personal integrity, ensure that justice were equitable, handle for all. The spirit of the law was to be the norm guiding the judicial decisions. Avoid plotting evil in their heart against others and desiring to take false oath against them. 17. Whatever God hate, they had to hate it. All right. The coming of a new day. God has expectations. All right? And it's only the coming of the new day is only possible with the requirements that God has given us, the expectation that He has for us. All believers are guaranteed that they will enjoy the new day that will come at His set time, but not without divine expectation on their part. The great salvation we have received and the faithfulness of God's promise is contingent upon the requirements. Huh? We have experienced a more than enough reason to commit to the same requirement, expectation. All right? We should speak truth. We should have a life that is characterized by justice and integrity. All right? And that is both individually and collectively. All right? God wants us to live up to those expectations. Be ye holy as I am holy. Question comes to mind. In what way would participation in ministry opportunities change if what God expects of those who have experienced the blessing of salvation was the primary focus? You don't have to ponder that now. You don't have to ponder it now. This is just a question that I'm throwing out there. Accepting Christ as our Savior gives us a new status. And it's reversed, and it reversed our life's condition, resulting in blessings now and in the future. Let me read that again. Accepting Christ as Savior gives us a new status. And it reversed our life condition, resulting in blessings now and in the future. We should be committed to live out His expectation, God's expectation. We should live a godly life, and that godly life should be characterized by truthfulness, integrity, justice, and honesty. All right? It is reassuring to know that God has divinely planned a new day for those who have become a part of the community of faith. The condition that characterizes this present world may appear unstoppable, but we can balance our uncertainty above them with the certainty of God's word that justice and peace will become realities. God bless you with this lesson. I just thank God for being able to do this. God is blessing day by day. Let us pray. Dear God, as you know, we come to you just to say thank you. As you come to us with new beginnings, help us to repent of our old ways and to open our hearts to the newness of life that your presence brings. Give us a sense of community and help us to always remember that those who are the most vulnerable among us, never let us forget the hope, the peace, and the justice that we are called upon to live out in our daily lives that you have made possible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, I want to thank God for this lesson because it's a timely lesson. I want to thank you, all those that are able to hear. And I just want to leave this with you, all right? I want to leave this with you, all right? Because I know He knows my name. Huh?
He said, you know my name.
He knows my name. Does he know your name? A new day coming. A new day is coming. God bless you and God keep you. This is my prayer.